Hei, før du hører på denne podcasten her, så vil jeg bare informere om at lyden ble ikke helt slik jeg hadde hoppet på. Hva som skjedde vet jeg ikke, men Skype så gikk ut til samarbeidet den dagen jeg skulle gjøre dette her. Så dere må kanskje vri litt frem og tilbake på volumknotten her, når du hører denne podcasten. Men uansett, dette en podcast med intervju med Jason Reed, så jeg håper det liker den fra Trondplot Productions. Ha en ellers fin dag.
God dag, dette Trond Vatnetveiten for Trondplot Productions. Det andre del av... normalt sin podcastserie på høyt tid og denne gangen skal vi snakke med Jason Reed fra Leap UK. Hello Jason.
Hi there, how's it going?
It's been great here, it's cold like ever. Norwegian summer, only grey.
That's pretty much a British summer as well. We've pretty much had complete rainfall in a week this year.
Oh, a week? Well, we had I live in Bergen, so we had a 5 years ago a record on 100 days in a row.
Wow, yeah, I think that just about beats us, I think.
So, you are a writer, blogger, film producer, the film we're going to talk about a little later. You're blogging for the Huffington Post,
yeah.
UK edition, you also guest blog for Virgin, Political, Co-UK, The Independent, Sundog Picture, London Real TV, oh my god, just BBC, Channel 4, Huffington Post Live and everything really there is.
the way I describe it is basically a drug policy marketeer. I think that's the most succinct way of saying what I do.
Yeah. But yeah, like you are everywhere there is. So, well, I talked about people in the Leap or the American organization, but... a little about you. How did you come to work for Leap?
I started blogging, just doing like a blog spot, and realised that not many people were doing entry-level drug policy, so a lot of it was academically based. And to me, it was going over my head. So with a basic understanding of what was going on, I could only imagine what a layman was going through. So I decided to branch out, did a bit more writing, my blog took off, got in some... combative debates with some prominent columnists here, which got me some attention. And then I was one of the first ones to join up to the Huffington Post UK edition to blog about drug policy. And from there, the exposure just took off because the Huffington Post really did well in this country. I don't want to say it's a left-wing leaning, but it kind of is. There's no getting away from the fact that you've got... in this country, still very much left and right leaning publications, and Huffington Post is going to be on the left of that spectrum. And because I was one of the first ones to join the Huffington Post, it just got that spread, and they got behind some of the articles that I was doing. And then I realised that I wanted to do more than just preach to the converted, because a lot of times in drug policy, you can just be within this echo chamber where we're just discussing amongst ourselves. So I saw Leap in the US, and I thought, well, there's not going to be many people that aren't going to listen to a bunch of police officers, intelligence officers, military. These are the ones that have been on the front line of drug policy, fighting the war on drug, literally. So I inquired to see if they had a UK branch. And at that point, they really only had a couple of speakers and a Facebook page. So I just said, well, I'd like to get involved just to volunteer my services. And then started building it, and a few more people started getting on board. And then from there, it just took off. And now we've got, well, I can't even count the amount of speakers we've got now. And we only really officially, I use that in inverted commas, launched in February. We were going a long time before that, but we operated under the global Leap banner. Yeah. But to get some really good coverage and leverage, it really does help to have regionalised branches so that, you know, we know our media, we know the way that our cultural system works, so that we can do things within that. And that's what we did. We ended up launching in February in the Houses of Parliament, and it's been going since then.
But it's the same problem your country as it is mine, because I always talk with some law enforcement people behind closed doors, and say, yeah, we agree with you, but we can't say it because it's our career.
Yeah.
Is the same problem in Britain?
It is. But it's just starting to turn now because, strangely, we had this... when the coalition government came in 2010 of Conservatives and Liberal Democrats, they brought in this new role called a PCC, which is a Police and Crime Commissioner, which sounds very Batman, and it is. It's like an elected person that heads up constabularies, so regional branches of the police. That role, on the face of it, seems like a horrific idea. To have a politicised role within the police, it just doesn't sound very good.
No, and it sounds like a blast from a history of Europe we don't want to go back to.
Exactly, yeah, it really does. And with a citizen's hat on, I still object to it. But with a drug policy hat on, it actually does us some real good favours, because it means that you can properly regionalise what we're doing. Because one of the issues that, or one of the advantages that America have got that we necessarily haven't, is the fact that they're state by state, so they can break down incrementally their drug policy reforms. Whereas if here, fundamentally, we're completely federal because we work on a national basis. So stripping down to these regionalised figures, it meant that we could have incremental reforms coming. So even though our government is not moving at all when it comes to drug policy reforms, we can use the position of the PCC, who are there to set priorities, there to put out a manifesto of what they want to see. We can use that role to break down and actually have some tangible reforms in place. So what we're finding is cannabis, for example. There's quite a few constabularies that are deprioritising cannabis. So we're not getting a de facto decriminalisation, but it means that a lot less people are going through the mill with regards to arrests, prosecutions. A lot of times they're still focusing on big level dealing, but with regards to possession, they've backed off. So it means that we're getting some really good advantages. And we found that there's one person up in the north of our country, a PCC called Ron Hogg. And he's done some brilliant work in harm reduction and drug policy reform in general. And he was the first one to go on record saying, right, we're deprioritising cannabis. We're going to make sure that we apply resources to where it needs in society. And sure enough, they've been rated the best in the country. So but through that deprioritisation, it means that we're actually seeing better results in other areas of crime.
But you have a new government. I'm a very conservative one.
Very.
Too much conservative for my taste, but as a member of the Liberal Party of Norway, everything is too conservative for me. But how do you think that's going to change? Because now Britain goes after the European Union and so on. Which consequences would that have for the drug policy of Britain?
It is a strange time here now, it really is. No one's really quite sure what's going on. In 2010, when we had the coalition government, again, we'd never really had a coalition before, so it was new ground. And it turned out to be pretty advantageous. The Liberal Democrats that were there to alongside the Conservative Party really did ameliorate the hard edge that can come in with that right-leaning government. So there was a good spread. You know, everybody, it was a middle ground, and the middle ground seemed to work quite well. But now, as you said, we've got this shift over to quite a right wing. And also some new figures that are coming through that aren't necessarily affable to the international perception of what we're like, and also just quite hard-edged in the way they look at it. The Prime Minister that we've got now, and again, I don't want to go straight into criticising the Prime Minister, because that's not going to help us at all. You know, we need to have good dialogue. But her track record is no getting away from that. When we released a report a few years ago called the International Comparators Report, one of the key findings of that was that if you look across all the countries, Portugal, us, you find that there's no correlation between a country's harshness of their drug laws and the level of use. So we know that drug laws don't deter use. Our Prime Minister, who was then Home Secretary, wanted to redact that. She wanted that out of the report. And there was a big fight within the government to keep that line. She wanted it out. That just gives you an indication of what we're dealing with. There was a famous quote a couple of weeks ago that one of the ministers that's now gone, he's now lost his seat in the reshuffle, called Michael Gove. He said on a live debate, well, this country is sick of experts. And that kind of wraps up what it's like in drug policy at the moment. We've had expert after expert come out in this country, really advocating for massive changes.
We had David Nutter in Bergen.
Exactly, yeah.
And he got a lot of trouble. He's going to come on a later podcast. He said yes to us also. But he got a lot of trouble. He should... What he come to, I didn't find very controversial, really. It's science. It's like climate science. It's like, this is what's happening.
Yeah, and it's just bizarre. We're in this bizarre set of circumstances now where literal experts, the ones that are heading up their field and even appointed to the government advisory, that are getting rejected their view based on prejudice, existing prejudice. And this indicates more than prominently that decisions already made and then evidence follows the decision making as opposed to evidence leading the decision making. And this is the trouble that we're going to be having for a while, I think, in this country now that we've had a change in government. There's every chance that experts will get ignored and we're just going to go in favour of what our emotive opinion takes us. And also, the media does play a massive part in how it sways public opinion.
Yeah.
So we've got this crossover between what the politicians think the public want to hear and what they're led to believe through the media, and it just turns into this muddy mess.
But is it the same? Because I used to have a radio programmer in Bergen, and I got kicked out just because of mentioning the cannabis debate. Is it like that in British media too?
It still is that hard edge. We've got, if you look at the publications that we have here, the one that you'll probably hear the most is the Daily Mail. They quite often come up. And it's fairly clear that their editorial position is that they don't put out much in the way of measured responses on drug policy. But then you've got other right-leaning publications like The Sun, which is Murdoch Press. And in the past, they've been very much for prohibition. But if you've looked at their editorial stance over the last few years, it's been gravitating towards a more moderate approach, even to the point of there's certainly an indication of decriminalisation bias. I think it's changing. I think that my personal belief is that public does lead opinion and they will always sway what's going on in policy making, whether it's cerebral or not. And then if you can get a change within communities and you can get a change within just the social construct, that's going to filter. So it's that typical response of it starts at the bottom up, not the top down.
Yeah, because for me it's often been the debate about the debate. It's like we are still debating here in Norway whether we're going to have a new debate or not. And I think for me that's absurd. I think everything can be debated. Everything could be on the table. We are debating, and we usually say, like, people who mean that is like this, and people who means that is like that. It's like, how is that? Why don't you not even? I don't feel like you have even legalized the debate itself.
I completely agree with that. I think that we still haven't legitimized it. I think that it's still hush hush. You know, don't talk about it. It's drugs. It's in that bracket of dirty, and we can't. And it's difficult because I imagine you and I are both the same in the sense that we're quite used to talking about drugs. We've got a circle of friends where it's a discussion topic. So we're desensitized to it. You know, if we hear the word drugs, it just automatically triggers our interest because that's what we're doing. But then I've had conversations around family members, around extended family, and you start talking about drugs, you can see them actively recoil. You know, it's frightening to them. It's embarrassing to have that word come up. And I think we're getting better, but I don't think we're there in the sense that we're managing to really pitch to the ears that it's needed yet.
Half of the people when I mentioned to my family, are you using drugs? Do you have a drug problem? No, I don't. I don't nearly drink at all. Mm. My biggest addiction is coffee, and I can't get enough of coffee. But that's still legal. But that is the debate, really.
Yeah, and this is what we're finding here, is that if you can get these hooks that can get people interested, so whether it be I know that it can be quite a jaded view, but if you can get celebrity figures to just kind of start pushing it a little bit, which we are finding now. Russell Brand, for example, is a contentious figure. Some people love him, some people hate him, but there's no denying that with the programs that he's done, he managed to get some extra exposures that the drug policy sector as an academic base wouldn't necessarily get to.
Yeah, we tried that in Norway, and that's just the elite, big people who just think about their own drug use. That is the answer from the police and so on. So we have a lot to do that. But I'm also going to take back a little bit in the history making here. Because for me, when I look back in history, the logic behind banning cannabis and other drugs are very strange.
Yeah. It is bizarre.
It's bizarre when you go back to the 1800s. They started this just for... they were just angry Chinese who took the jobs, black people who took the jobs. Even if you go back to Nixon, he admitted, really, that was more a fight against people who had a culture that he didn't like, rather than the drug itself.
You find that prohibitions do, in some way, dovetail to a prejudice. So, you know, we can use the Harrison Act, for example. That was there. When we researched that, we know that it's there to segregate what a white middle-class America was like, as opposed to the ethnic tide that was starting to come in. And it's the same with if you read Johann Harry's Chasing the Scream, he makes a brilliant job of describing what it's like with Billie Holiday and the jazz movement, and how the jazz movement was very much involved with cannabis and marijuana. And that was against the sensibilities to the people at the time, Harry Anslinger and that kind of group. And if you, each time that you do have a drug prohibition, it tends to in some way relate to a social persecution. And it still carries on now with the disparity in crack cocaine and powder cocaine. It's still there. Obama did a fair job to equalise it, but not enough. It's still, if you're going under the premise that we do have penalties for drugs, which of course neither one of us agrees with, then surely it makes sense to have a drug which has got relatively equal harm to be of equal punishment. But it's not. Crack cocaine is still punishable. I think it's 3-1. I might be wrong on that, but it's still far more than what powder cocaine is.
I had an experience, because there have been some so-called scandals there, you know, where a politician got caught with some marijuana, and their career is destroyed. Why, another government official who was buying prostitutes was okay. What do you find about that? Because that's going to be even more absurd. Just using cannabis is enough to destroy a career in Norway.
And that's where it's completely wrong. You know, if you look at that, that someone is using a substance, and then you prosecute them and they lose their job, well, of course, their life's going to spiral even further down. So you're not in any way helping them. If you go under the premise that you're arresting someone for the good of their own health, then you've just completely exacerbated the circle that they're going to be in. And the same, and there is a really big crossover between sex worker rights and drug user rights. We get a lot, within LEAP, we get a lot of people from the sex worker community coming our way saying, well, there's still harm reduction practices you can do in it. There's still education that dovetails. And it's, you know, obviously within LEAP with single issues, so we can't necessarily touch it, but we can certainly be sensitive to it as well, because a lot of times we find as well that sex workers do use drugs, not all the time, obviously. So there's a big conversation there in general. And if you use the word vice, which, again, I don't like to use the word vice, but if we're going to broadly label this, it all comes under the same bracket of people's civil liberties. Do we really want to affect people's job prospects and their lives in general by ruining them through prosecutions? Of course we don't. It doesn't work. And we haven't had much in the way of drug scandals in this country lately, even though the fact that I think it was The Sun again, which is the news publication I said about earlier, they did a swab test throughout their Houses of Parliament toilets. Oh, yeah. and they found such traces of cocaine. You know, it goes without saying that there are very much people within the halls of power that are using substances that aren't necessarily legal.
They did the same in Norway, so they found many same results.
And yet we can't have a conversation about it. You know, the people that make the laws, we know that they've got friends and family that have got addictions or don't have addictions and use safely and ethically or however you want to term it, but we still can't have the conversation of not letting them be criminals. And I think the reason we don't have that conversation is because they're the ones that don't tend to get caught. It's very much the ones at the lower socio-economic classes that are the ones that go through the mill with regards to prosecution. The ones that are in the upper echelons of society can pretty much get away with what they want.
I think it's interesting, because if a politician, and we had two of the politicians who said they were for it in Norway, was caught afterward, the police started investigating them. That was very interesting. But it's one thing more, because I remember when Bill Clinton resigned from office, 2 weeks later he said, yeah, I'm for legalization of cannabis. I think maybe Obama gonna do exactly the same thing. But why do they have to wait? Why do they have to wait after they come out of office? That is so people cannot even, politicians don't dare to do so. It's, for me, so incredible, insane.
It is difficult because, I mean, on one side, I completely agree with that, that it is so frustrating to just put your colours to the mast. It's really not that big a deal. And I think most people just would not care. So if a leader came out and said, right, we need to do this, I think most people go, okay, I'm with that. I think there's not enough support to keep prohibition in place. And I think there's a lot of support to end it. Now, I think one of the reasons that we don't have politicians and people of power coming out while they're in there is the political system itself, because a lot of times you find that our leaders are not necessarily there having a free voice. You know, they're beholden to their party, to the whips. Well, obviously they set the whips mandate, but the whips are very much integral to the what goes on. And I think that there's, because of the consensus and because of the party fundings that happen as well, I think it's such a tightrope of how they have to walk that you see that the rhetoric starts to change in the way that they're softer towards it. Like Obama, even though he hasn't come out and said, right, we need to legalise cannabis, which he pretty much did promise before he was in office, yeah. And then it went soft on it. I think that he has made some... The fact that he hasn't blocked state-by-state reforms, the fact that there is a conversation about reclassification so that it's not Schedule 1. And I think if he leaves office, I think that might be what he would do. I think it might be reclassified so it's not on a schedule with heroin in class 1.
Yeah, but he has used the, under Obama administration, he has also stopped a lot of dispensary for medical marijuana.
That's true.
Predecessor, really.
Yeah. Yeah, he's, that is true. The legacy of the raids and things like that have not been good, especially in the early part of his term. And it is frustrating. I know a lot of people in America that do follow Obama's work religiously because that's their job. They're there to be a sentinel within marijuana policy. And I know they get frustrated. I know that they know Obama's position is very much different from his public one.
That is, yeah, I'm still a little bit frustrated over that. But really, we have some experience here with new drug policy in Europe. I see, for me, Portugal is one of the best. Switzerland, another, really, who's really working. Especially when it comes to heroin and harder drugs, Portugal and Switzerland have been a success story.
Yeah.
Why doesn't the science says it all? Because I try to... Because the thing that I get met here in Norway is like, yeah, but we have a different culture in Norway. Yeah, more people drive drugs in Norway than anywhere else in Europe. Why don't people say, like, Portugal, yeah, that works. Switzerland, yeah, that works. Why doesn't they copy it?
I think we're the same in this country as well, in the UK, where I think we're so engineered towards having a success or a failure based on the numerical position of usage. I think that if your usage starts to dip on drugs, then it's like, oh, finally we got success because more people aren't taking drugs. And that's just perverse because, as you said, we've got a terrible death rate in this country for drug users. It's gone up. I think we're at an all-time high now. My chairman, Neil Woods, who is an undercover drugs detective, this is where he would be a good one to speak to because he's passionate about this area. And I think that once we got this perversion in our mind that the only way to measure a successful drug policy is through the dip of use, it's a very bad road to go down. And as you said, when you look at even Sweden that's got a very harsh drug policy to the point where in this country, the laws are on possession. So if you're caught in possession, that's when you could go through through prosecution. Whereas in Sweden, you can have it in your system. You know, if it's detectable within your urine or blood, then you can be prosecuted.
Yeah. So just asking that, because some people in this country said that Sweden is a success story. What's your comment to that?
Again, just look at their death rates. The death rates are, I think, on a par or worse with us. I did check them the other day, actually. There's a great blog from Transform Drug Policy Foundation. I'll try and quickly find a link to it so that I can speak about it. But they're frustrated on this issue, that the fact that people do use Sweden as a successful model. And you have to then weigh up what that means. Well, if you want a complete erosion of civil liberties, then it's a success. if you want a complete overhaul of how we perceive harm, then it's a success because, like I said, it's driving death rates up. I don't personally think that's a success, and I don't think that many people in a country, which, even though the UK is quite conservative, we still are liberal-leaning. And if it gets to the point where we're having drug policy, which means that the drugs in your system allows the state to invade your life and prosecute you, I don't think this country would stand for that. I think that's when we would go, hang on a minute, things have gone a little bit awry. So the worse it gets, the almost stronger reform gets, if that makes sense.
In Norway, the scandals often are found by high schools. They go after students, musical festivals, and so on, with search dog and everything. And they make big headlines every week that they found some drugs in the festival, and they stop people, and so on, and so on, and so on. They have had some of them, they make contracts with young people, like, if you keep on the... admit that you have a problem, and you go to therapy, and everything. It's like... admitting you have a problem and you don't necessarily have one.
I'm starting
in Norway now. That's obviously, this is basically very hard against civil liberties.
Exactly.
And Norway is very to the left, so how can you explain that?
And I've just found, so if people want to see that Sweden report, just Google drug policy in Sweden, a repressive approach that increases harm. And that's the Transform Drug Policy Foundation that does a very good analysis of it. And as you said, you do have to weigh up civil liberties to freedom and also the harms that come within that. And there is a broad conversation within that. But if you could compare Sweden to even Ireland now, Ireland are progressing really well. Our neighbours, they're probably going for a decriminalisation across the board. They're talking about supervised injecting sites. There's talk of medicinal cannabis and potential further cannabis reforms, and it's quite strange. You'd imagine the UK to be in that position before Ireland, and the fact that Ireland are going before us indicates that we really are behind in the UK now. And fair play to Ireland. I really hope they go ahead with it, because I think it would be very useful to them.
But how does the public see this? Because I know you have a Liberal Party. Where's the Liberal Party written in this? Because, well, Liberal Party, this should be their elegant agenda.
We had the coalition government in 2010, which was fronted by, as I said, the Conservatives and the Liberals. Unfortunately, after that, because of some of the decisions that took place in there, the Liberal Party got wiped out in the 2015 election. So we've only got, I think it's 8 now, and it was something like 58 before that. So they lost around 50 MPs.
Oh, shit.
Yeah, so they really took hammering, and it was. And now, retrospectively, people are looking back and thinking actually that was quite unfair, because the Liberal Party, a lot of people have got quite a nostalgic view on them now, because they realised that they were there to temper the hard right that was coming through. But they've still been really good. They've been really active on drug policy. They've seen that there is not a niche there for a political party in drug policy reform, because they've been championing the issue for a long time. But there certainly is vote winning in champion drug policy, and you could argue that that's what happened in Canada with the Liberals and the new Prime Minister there now, that's making some pretty massive legalisation in quotation marks. I think we're going to get there, and the Liberal Democrats in this country again put out a report, or they basically manifestoed the issue of drug policy reform, especially cannabis. They really nailed their colours now. They've gone, right, we're championing this issue, this is ours. And it's only really the Liberal Democrats and the Green Party that are doing that. The rest of our political parties are still wishy-washy, don't know how to decide it. There's chance, and there's ways that we can help bring the change around within the parties, but the Liberal
Labour Party, people for the low middle class people, working class people, not even them.
But you'd expect it, wouldn't you? You really would think that they would understand what the socio-economic issues are of drug policy. And the new leader that we got, which is Jeremy Corbyn, who's a contentious figure, some people love him, people hate him. Before he was in office, he completely got it. He's on record International Drug Policy Consortium, IDPC. He did a speech with them I think it was about 2009, I might be wrong, but he again, he completely gets it. He understood decriminalisation, he understood the need for it. But unfortunately, it's that same thing again, that once he's in office, he has to put that policy out to the people that are there to shadow the arguments, so the Home Secretary, they then have to make the decisions, they have party consensus. So the leader can set an agenda, but if the party consensus isn't necessarily there. And because the Labour Party was so bad previously under Gordon Brown, that was the ones that reclassified cannabis to a harder position through the whole Professor Nutt debacle, it doesn't really, it gives you an indication that the Labour Party still aren't really there to grasp the nettle yet. They still haven't got it.
I just have to back you up, because again, this was Nixon's war. That's why I wonder how the Liberals and the Labour movement and the people on the left just follow the same argument as administration. That's what I don't get. They do the same here in Norway too. Like, no, this is not your history. It's the far right's history. Why are you following them in these questions? What happened during the war that I didn't get?
Exactly. And this is, you could argue that this is a wider issue, that if anything, then the rest of the country leaves because of how integral they are to the UN and how much that dictates policy. And see the effects of it here, that, I mean, I don't want to start spreading this issue out into other sectors, but a report came out here recently how we also, are you still there?
Yeah, I'm still here.
Just went all quiet. We tend to go where America tells us, and I was going to react now that after our European exit, it might get worse, it might get better, and it depends what happens with Donald Trump, if that gets in, and how that's going to react. So it's all up in the air of how much we are going to start following their policies from this point on. But historically, they are the trendsetter. They put the policies on the map, and then we act. And it's strange. You can separate that culturally. I think that we've got a better approach to harm reduction in this country with regards to needle exchange, heroin-assisted treatment. Also, we do get decriminalisation. We do understand it because we've come through the legal highs, as they're called, or psychosis. We have criminalised possession. We've made sure that we've stopped short of that. It's still very much law enforcement is focused on supply. So we understand how decriminalisation helps individuals, but we still can't apply that to wider drug policy, and that's because of the UN conventions and what the perception of sanctions that have come through because of people like the US. But then if you look at Uruguay and Canada now, you can't sanction Canada, you know, that are so prominent in the world stakes. So they're going to go ahead and do this. And then if they do that, it's probably going to set the way for other countries to go, actually, we can do it now.
I had a big hope for the UN now when they met in April, but I was so disappointed. What happened?
It was a washout, when it didn't really go anywhere. And I think it's because it always goes for the lowest common denominator. Because you had countries like Russia and the hardline ones like Singapore saying, no, for example, there are still, I think it was 8 countries now that still support death penalty for drug use. So all the way you've got that core that's sinking us down at the bottom, then you're not going to be able to get those overarching reforms at the top. So unfortunately, it is going to have to be an international consensus to some degree. We probably will segregate at some point because ideologies are so separate. But the UNGAS was disappointing. I think most people realised that UNGAS was going to be just another going through the motions. But it served well to get some messages out there. It meant that we could do some press work around it. And I still maintain that it's going to have to be a cultural change at the bottom. Just like if you can look at other social rights that have been out there in the past, civil liberties, it's that same core and the same momentums that we're going to need in this discussion.
But also the money here. In American politics, it's always all about the money. And the people behind try to stop the probation, there's very hard-line people, like people who own private prison, like the medical industry, who's very powerful, too powerful. Even Norway, they are powerful. Why doesn't that get addressed?
There are a lot of vested interests to keep how it is.
In the breweries, I heard in Britain, started tried to stop legalization of cannabis.
We've got some strange alliances like that. Again, in America, there's a gambling mogul that's trying to prevent some reforms going through. So someone's going to get dented profits somewhere along the lines if we had regulated cannabis systems, whether it be private prisons, whether it be the knock-on effects to industries like alcohol or even potentially pharmaceuticals. I noticed the Young Turks put out a piece the other day about how the pharmaceutical industry is getting a bit of a dent now. I don't think it's going to be hugely significant because the pharmaceutical industry is a Goliath in its own right. But if you only chip away at one tiny bit of profits from each one of these sectors, then you made powerful enemies. And especially privatised prison system. We're not quite so bad in this country in the way that it's so widespread. But I think the privatised prison system here is creeping through, and I think per capita, I think we're worse, if I remember rightly. And if that takes a hold, then privatised prisons need people to fill it. Drug consumers are the low-hanging fruit, as they say. And you can see how that is a self-fulfilling prophecy.
I'm going to say that there's a fun fact there, because in Norway we don't have enough prison space. So we send the people to Netherlands. The people in Netherlands have stopped. They have a lot of open capacity.
That's it, yeah.
They stop punishing people using drugs. So that's very interesting there.
And how bizarre is that as well, that you're having to offset your own prison population to another country? That's almost, you know, again, historically, that goes back to what we were doing in the Victorian times. We've got this strange archetypal view again, but we can't see it at the moment. You know, we're so blinkered in our approach. And you have to remember as well, as drug laws are quite recent history. You know, that you go back to previous centuries, it wouldn't have even been dreamt of that consuming something would put you in a position of prosecution.
No, that's also, people said, I discussed, like, yeah, if you want to legalize cannabis, you're legalizing crime. So why not legalize burglary or rape? If you were like,
yep.
That is the argument I get met with. You want to legalize criminal acts.
It's quite a simple response to that as well. Because we've got ways of differentiating law. We know that, obviously, in our conversation, we're very much aware that someone that's smoking cannabis or maybe injecting drugs for whatever reason is certainly not going to be the same as someone that's burglary or rape or murder. But if you want to separate that by law, we've got a thing called mala in se, which is an evil in itself, which is murder, rape, burglary. It involves a victimised crime. And then you've got mala prohibitum, which means that the state has seen it fit to sanction something, prohibit something, and therefore you can get prosecuted for it. So we know that there's separate laws, but we shouldn't even need to explain that, because it's just, you know, such a moot point.
Yeah, I have a problem, but this is still a legitimate argument, even from the left to the right, in the politics, so...
Yeah.
Conservative government now, they don't want to legalize anything. They believe in more jail time.
Really?
Stop young people. They have putting. They want forced testing at school sometimes.
Oh, you're kidding.
No, I'm not kidding.
So this is a realm that really worries me, is mandatory testing. Because, again, if you go down that route, you're going down the Swedish route, you're going down an erosion of civil liberties, and there needs to be a respectable buffer between state and citizen.
And you're filling up the prisons.
Yeah. And I imagine in this country, we certainly can't afford that right in the moment. I'm not sure about Norway, but we can't afford all those prisons and the amount of prisoners. And the only way we could is through a privatised system. And again, if we go down that route, then it's a scary realm.
I don't want... I'm pro-business, but I'm not business on everything when it comes to health, schools and prison. I'm out. But we have a strange thing, because this is what I often meet. Because I work as a security guard, and I say we put in people, young people in prison, who have had some drug problems, and they are coming out and get more and more criminal every time because they get more hardline. How can we really defend a system who just use the prisons as like high school fed criminal education?
And we're having a bit of a conversation. Well, we were having a conversation on that here. Michael Gove, who's now left government, he was putting judicial reform and prison reform on the map. And we had some great documentaries that came out as well on our national TV and our channels about what the prison system does to an individual and how it perpetuates harm. I don't know how we can get outside of the mentality that prisons are in any way, shape or form rehabilitation, because they're just out and out not. Once you go in there, it's going to be very difficult to get your life back on track. And there's an organisation here called the Howard League for Penal Reform that are brilliant at this. You know, they're arguing for less prisons, more in the way of intelligent sentencing, and also just, as you said, education, because it's needed. If you can go in, if you've committed a crime, which there are plenty out there that you can do, if you do get prosecuted for it, and the chances are you're not going to be able to get your life back on track because of what that prosecution does. I think it's one of the Leap founders called Jack Cole. One of his sayings is that if you've got a drug conviction, now let me get this straight, you can recover from a conviction, but you can't, no, you can recover from an addiction, but you can't recover from a conviction. Sorry, I've completely messed that up, but you get the idea. It's easier to arguably, and I don't want to belittle anybody's plight of what they've gone through with fighting an addiction, because it's, you know, that needs utmost sensitivity and respect. But it's true that you can make a case that if you have got a conviction to your name, your life is going to be so much harder to get on with, especially in America, because of, you know, you're not going to be able to go to college. So how do you get your life back on track from that point? So you can see how it's a self-fulfilling prophecy that once you're on that road of criminality, that it's only going to get worse from that point on.
Yes, also it's enormous expense if you can use it on helping people with problems.
Mm. And this is what happened in Portugal. They managed to apply their budget from a criminal justice over to a health, and they're not going to be turning back. You know, they've realised that this works. And again, in Ireland, they're going to be doing the same.
Yeah.
I think we're getting there in this country in the sense that we're starting to realise that we're going to, if we apply our resources to health as opposed to prosecution, it has benefits. But I think it's going to be a softer approach. I think it's going to be done through a bit of a backdoor action as opposed to it just being hailed in the papers.
I'm going to take some issues from Norway now, because there's a lot of discussion here about what is the result of the Colorado and Washington drug policies. The people are against legalization. They say, oh, it went to hell. It's failure. We don't have to do that in Norway. What is your opinion on that? Or what is the science says about that? It's better to ask.
It's certainly interesting, because I think one of the things, if we're pro-drug policy reform, then I think we do need to contextualise it that there is no one-size-fits-all. I think we do need to there can be a tendency to say, right, all reform is a success. But it's how you measure that multi-criteria analysis. So Colorado have done brilliant on their taxation. I can't remember what it is now. It's ridiculous amounts of taxation that they've managed to roll in, which some of it's going to schools, some of it's going to rehabs. Some people are saying that there's a little bit of a failure in the sense that of marketing. They've not learnt from tobacco and alcohol marketing like we have in this country, where we've limited it now. We don't mind regulating things in this country in the sense that we don't tend to... Yeah, we're socialist leaning, and we don't use the word socialist as a dirty word, whereas in America... in America, they very much still view socialism as a kind of a throwback to an era that wasn't useful. whereas once they realise that socialism doesn't mean what they think it means, it just means a bit of more of a social awareness. And with the taxation process, it's great for accumulating that they can go back and roll in. But you can do things as well to ameliorate the marketing. So if you look at Uruguay compared to Colorado, Uruguay have gone for that state regulation model, which means that it's in the hands of the state. They're going to grow, they're going to distribute, they're going to set the taxation level so that it's just right to get some profit, but at the same time that it's not pricing out the black market, because you need to think in terms that if you set a taxation too high, can it enforce the black market? There is some evidence that the black market exists in Colorado, but it's early days. There isn't going to be that, right, we've sorted it out now. This is going to be a work in progress for a lot of time. We've had a prohibition in place for so many decades that we're going to need to understand that incremental steps are going to get us to where we need to be. So Colorado are doing great and a great success. I don't think it's a model that we're necessarily going to employ in the UK. I think that we're more likely to go for a softer approach like the Spanish social club model, or even a mix between Uruguay state model and Spanish social club model.
Explain that social club model. All of my listeners know what that is.
It's very interesting. This is the one that I've got quite a lot of faith in personally. We've got a social club movement in this country as well, called the United Kingdom Cannabis Social Clubs, UKCSC. And what it is, in Spain, it started under a constitutional loophole. They realised that they could get together these collectives. So if you're in a town, you can get a few people together and you can grow and distribute your own cannabis between you, which, again, it just forms a very rudimentary Spanish social club. That then took off and started going into a bit more mainstream. So if you go into... I've never personally been to Spain, but I know a lot of people have. So you can go into a club or a bar, and there'll be a little doorway that is very discreet, which takes you into a back room, and that's where the social club model is. And they've got all the cannabis there, so it's very discreet. It's out of the way. It's not intrusive to people that have... they've got sensibilities against it, and it's just that it's a cooperative, it's a selective group that have gone, right, we're going to play a certain amount to be into this, we're going to be autonomous between us, and we're just going to get on with it. And that's what Spain did, and we've started to do that in this country. Obviously we can't do it legally in this country, but there's a movement here to get that softer regulation in place, which means that the consumers know the strain potency, they know they can test their own, they can set their own pricings, they can tag their plants as well, so they know what genetics are in place. If you put this in the hands of the people and the consumers that know cannabis, and let's face it, I think we both know there are a lot of people out there that do know cannabis, why wouldn't that be a good regulatory model?
You know, we have a regulatory model because alcohol's stronger than 22% have to be sale of the state monopoly.
Mm.
So what we are talking about, you know, it's like we want cannabis in that model too.
Yeah, it makes sense.
We have a ban on commercial for alcohol. It's also worked fine. So that is the Norwegian model. We have state shops usually in every city there is. They tried to limit it 20 years ago. That only felt the more smuggling. The smuggling is not that big now. So they have a state shop. Is that a model? Like we have that in Norway and Sweden already. Just apply to also using cannabis. Would that be a good idea?
Yeah, I think you can learn from previous health success. Health success in this country is tobacco. We've lessened tobacco through education, through setting a pricing limit, which some people will argue that it's, again, unfair on the poor because you're pricing things out of their... level of what they can pay. And it's a difficult balance, because how do you set a pricing limit that makes you realise that actually this isn't good for me, therefore I have to consider if I want to pay that much to do something that's fundamentally against my own judgement on health, but at the same time not persecute the people that are on the lower socioeconomic classes anyway. But tobacco as a health policy has been a success here because of taxation, because of plain packaging, because of we've limited the marketing of it. You could apply that to cannabis easily as well. You could set minimum pricing. You can set a plain packaging in the sense that, again, it doesn't have to be on the high street, branding in front of children. It can be discreet. We can set the rules on it. And if you're starting from scratch on a regulatory process, you can do what you want with it to make it how it works for the community. It just makes sense.
We're going to talk about it because you also have produced... co-produced a movie about this.
Yes.
High. It's for everybody who doesn't know it. It's on Netflix in Norway and hopefully many other countries.
Yeah, I think it's in Canada, America, and this country, in the UK. I think most of Europe, I think, has got it. But yeah, I was one of the associate producers. I basically did the UK side of things, where, again, I've got Professor Nutt involved, Howard Marks, bless Howard Marks. And also Richard Branson, people like that. And we had great success with it. And I was quite pleased as well, because it was because of being distributed on Netflix, and we had a theatrical run as well. We managed to get new ears into the discussion. We managed to get people that just generally don't care. Once you see these figures that are involved, again, Joe Rogan is big in America, so he attracts an audience. Snoop Dogg was in it.
Snoop Dogg, yeah. I don't think he's the best commercial for legalization.
What the interesting thing, because this is, again, another area that can be quite contentious, is the people that you get involved to advocate reform.
Well, I think he was banned from Norway for 2 years because he tried to smuggle Dilly and then Mario Hanna into Christian.
Oh, really? Actually, yeah, there was something similar like that here as well. Yeah, that's right, yeah. And he's got his own commercial brand now, hasn't he, out in America? Yeah, yeah. But like, they're useful because they can bring in their following. So, prime example, there's a comedian here that we work with called Rufus Hound, and he's got 1.2 million Twitter followers. Well, that's access to 1.2 million people that we wouldn't ordinarily have just because he's in the film. So it's useful just getting the new people in like that. So if you can get public figures that are willing to get involved, they bring an audience. And then also,
I was asking you, how did not anybody knows much about the movie itself and how it come to life? Because that's very interesting, because this was, when I saw it, I thought, wow, this was a lot of work. And it was not many people who want to sponsor a movie like that. I had a friend of mine who said, yeah, I gave some money to it. So how did they get that movie to become a movie?
There's a film called The Union, The Business Behind Getting High, which you can find on YouTube. And it was, I think, 2008, I think it was made. And it was a massive success on the internet. It was when the internet really started taking things off. You know, it really did well for pushing it out there in public domain. And because it was a bit of an underground commercial hit, well, say commercial hit, the makers of it, Adam Scorgi, Brett Harvey, friends of mine now, despite the fact that it had millions and millions of views and it did really well, the filmmakers are actually in debt because of the film, because they ended up just saying, right, we're in this for the greater good. You know, they're not activists. That's the thing. They don't use cannabis. They just saw an interesting story. Originally, they wanted to do an expose on the British Columbia marijuana industry in Canada. They saw that there was a big market there, so they wanted to do a bit of an expose. That then turned into a reform-leaning piece just through the way that the story was told. And they had no ambitions to go, right, we're in this for activism's sake. They just wanted to tell the story. From there, because it was such a commercial success, the public was saying, right, well, the story's even more involved now because things have happened, so can you do a sequel? And they resisted for a long, long time. But then I saw that the sequel was coming up, so we just got connected over the internet. And I said, look, there's a massive UK story within this as well, because Professor Nutt just happened, you know, the fact he got sacked for telling the truth. So Adam, the executive producer, again, a great personal friend of mine now, he saw the potential in the UK side of things and said, yeah, right, we're definitely coming over. So they got a Kickstarter together, and I think it got funded to the tune of $250,000, I think it was.
Oh, not bad.
Yeah, did well. And it just goes to show you the outpouring and the need to have a second film. People were really passionate about this. And it went into making. I think we made it for about 3 years, I think, that it took from research stage to booking stage and then release stage. And then we did it. We released it in 2014. And we had a premiere in Leicester Square, London, in the heart of our premiere. We got in the Oscar long listed as well, which is incredible. And it just goes to show that people are really interested in this discussion if you present it in the right way. I think that there's so many different facets to it and different strings that you start pulling away at one and then another one comes loose.
Because it's very good. I've seen Netflix now have started a lot of documentaries on that. You have the Cocaine Cowboys, you have the how to become make money selling drugs and so on. So yeah. Netflix has been very good for this course, really.
It is so useful as well. There's another one called Breaking the Taboo, which is done by Sam Branson's company, which is Richard Branson's son, Sundog Pictures. And again, brilliant documentary. I think it's 45 minutes. It's really nice and tight. And it makes a perfect case for a layman. So, and this is where people can get involved, because one of the things I imagine you get asked as well is that, we're interested in discussion, but what can we do? How can we help? We just have a family night, have a film night, get people round and go, right, we're going to watch this film and then have a discussion. It takes, what, an hour? And then you can have that discussion around what you're passionate about, and it's all presented for you. The facts are laid out. It's all there. That's what you can do to help, is these films are not there to just be viewed and say, yeah, I agree with that, and then move on. Get out there, organise community screenings, get people round, as I said, put Netflix on and have a Netflix and chill, as it were. You can get all of these different facets together and just go, right, we're going to actually have this discussion now.
Now, I mentioned some movies, but do you have any suggestions to the listeners, other kind of some movies they have to see?
Definitely. So I definitely recommend Breaking the Taboo. Yeah. Also, fictionalised things work as well. So I think that Cartel Land and... I must admit, this is a strange thing to admit, is that I'm not always up on the films that are coming out. Or especially the fictionalised ones, because I spend all of my time in drug policy reform, I don't tend to like to watch them in my off time. But also, there's a great one called Cocaine Unwrapped as well, which is directed by a lady called Rachel, which I saw the premiere of in London. And again, really recommend that, because it goes into the environmental impacts of eradication in Colombia. It goes into how women are disproportionately treated in prisons as well, because a lot of times women are focused on because of being couriers of drugs. They're the easy targets. So there's a lot of disproportionate levels of women in prisons in places like Colombia and Latin America. And these are all aspects that we don't necessarily always address within drug policy, of how much policies affect groups differently. So women, children, environment. These are all things that we need a discussion about as well.
I thought I was going to take that earlier, but I saw something that I would try to take up here in the end. It's because it's messy, but the death tolls of Mexico now was over 100,000, I think, since 2007.
That's it, yeah.
I think it's more than that. If that same amount of people have been killed in terror attacks, we'd be on alarm already. We've been changing politics already. Why isn't anything changing when you see the death tolls so much? You can go to Venezuela, you can go to Colombia, you can go to the American state, and death tolls are extremely high just because of the war. Why isn't it changing?
Exactly. I wish I knew, because I kind of literally lose sleep over this, of why have we gone so far off the rails that we can't see 100,000 lives being lost in somewhere, in some part of the world that's pretty close to us all, you know, in some cultural sense, and yet we're still not doing anything about it. And the only thing I can put it down to is the fact that it's a complicated issue that most people don't understand yet. Yeah. And I think that's where our jobs come in, of making people realise and presenting this in a moderate way as well, not shouting, not going, look what you're doing by prohibition. That doesn't help either. We need to go, actually, look, things are really going bad here.
And I'm probably getting my anger all back, because I'm so mad right now when I see the results.
It's easy to do. I think it's instinctual to go in with anger because of just how frustrating it is, and literally how heartbreaking it is, the fact that there are so many deaths. But if you speak to an elderly person on the street, they're not going to understand it if you come straight in with shouting. If their position was already made up on drugs, that drugs are bad, then instead of having a conversation about it, their back's going to go up, and you're going to have a defence against a defence.
Yeah.
That doesn't help. So if we can just have a moderate conversation of that this really does need addressing, and it's the way that you present the issue, I think, a lot of times, and I don't think we necessarily have got the presentation just spot on yet.
On the end of this podcast, I'm going to give you a reason to plug something, you know, books or something you write or things you got to read or watch. You mentioned some movies, but since you're a writer, is it something you have to read? Some web places we have to visit or to be more informed that you can recommend?
There's so much to recommend. I mean, there's so many organisations in this country that do brilliant work, like Release.org and Transform Drug Policy Foundation. And if you fancy having a read of what we do at Leap, UKLeap.org, a lot of times the blogs and the articles that I write get rolled into there, so it just gives you an idea. But one of the projects that we're really excited about at the moment is a podcast that we're doing as well called Stop and Search, which we've done cheekily, tongue-in-cheek, towards the horrible, insidious policy of Stop and Search in this country. Because we're a police organisation, we almost want to clutch that issue and go, hang on, we really, really need to speak about this. And what we're doing is audio documentaries, rolling news, also getting the public figures involved, as I was saying, so we can bring extra people along. And we're doing this under the Distraction Pieces Network, which is a rapper in this country called Scroobius Pip. He's lent out his network to us so that we can get extra exposure. And it's really working. We're doing quite well on it.
Okay. Oh, thank you for having me, being on, Jason.
Thank you so much.